A hospital employee steals the identity of a cancer patient, fighting for his life, certain he won't live long enough to tell. Well, guess what? He was wrong. Today, what you need to know about one of the most brazen and despicable scams ever.
I'm just an average guy. I love this country. My career was built on keeping people safe. Everyone deserves a life free of fear. I'm a fixer. I'm a protector. I believe in America. I'm here for you. It's time for a new conversation.
Our job here at the Security Brief is to talk about the things that will help keep your family safe. And that conversation always begins with a story.
In December 2002, I went into my local Red Cross to donate platelets for kids with leukemia. I've been doing it monthly for about 8 years. The volunteer nurse that checked me in almost every time I went in there noticed that I looked a bit pale, and when she tested my blood, found I was borderline anemic and thought I should see a doctor before I donate. The next day, I went and saw my doctor, and he immediately scheduled an appointment with a specialist. The specialist did a bone marrow biopsy and told me that my bone marrow was 100% cancerous. He told me that I had acute lymphoblastic leukemia and that without immediate treatment, I had less than a week to live. The next morning, I checked into Stanford Medical Center, and after 9 months of treatment there, I demanded transfer to the Fred Hutch Cancer Research Center in Seattle. Before I moved to Seattle, I closed most of my accounts because I didn't want to leave my family with a financial mess if I didn't make it. About a month after I arrived in Seattle, I began receiving thank you letters from banks and financial institutions thanking me for credit applications I had not submitted.
Please welcome Eric, and joining us via Skype is his mother, Cindy, to the Security Brief. What did you do when you started receiving these messages?
Well, at first, I just thought it was a clerical error. I mean, I had bigger things to worry about. So I called, I think it was one of the major banks and said, hey, this isn't me. You must have made a mistake. I'm not filling out any credit applications. As a matter of fact, I closed all my accounts, not wanting to leave a complicated mess for my family if I didn't make it. So
you're in there, you're fighting for your life.
Yes.
To keep this in perspective, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, no one can relate to that. I certainly can't. On the peripheral, I possibly can, because I lived with a friend through this. But you're going through horrendous pain. Can't imagine what's going through your mind. I read where you were grappling with the ability to even pick up the phone and make phone calls.
Yes, there was many times I was so sick that I couldn't get out of bed. I couldn't have conversations. I couldn't read. I couldn't. There were times when. Wasn't even sure that I'd make it through the week or through the night. So it was only, few and far between where I had the energy and ability to actually pursue it.
Cindy, thank you so much for joining. You're watching your son go through the most horrific time you could possibly imagine. And yet at the same time, you find him fighting for his identity. What were you thinking about that at that point?
I kept telling him to lie down. He's sick. This is just a mix-up. Just, you've got to concentrate on getting better, because he was so sick that I didn't want him to stress himself out with something that I didn't think was very important.
Now, obviously this is very important to you. What was your next step? What did you do with this next?
Well, I pretty much let it go after I called. I figured, they said, okay, we'll take care of it. Thanks for calling.
And who's they?
The bank, the major banks.
Because we would think you can trust the bank.
Why would they, if once they know that this is not a legitimate application, they're not going to, they'll close it and be done with it.
You figure you're good.
All good, yeah.
Okay, but that wasn't the case.
That was not the case.
Okay.
So in early, another month later, going through various treatments, I actually had an attempt at a bone marrow transplant that failed. And shortly afterwards, all the mail went to California. So my father, that would come every other week to stay with us, would bring, clumps of mail. And so he brought a clump of mail in, and all of a sudden now I find out that not only did they not shut down these accounts, but they still reported them as legitimate, and that allowed several other accounts to be opened. This is an identity theft.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And This happened, obviously, immediately upon my arrival in Seattle, or very shortly afterwards, and my only affiliations here have been with this hospital and maybe with the medical dormitory that I was living in.
So now you're starting to come to the realization that You've become victimized.
Targeted.
No question. And the only place this could have originated from was?
Through affiliations at the hospital.
Do you say anything to the people at the hospital?
Absolutely. I complained to the administration. I complained to my doctors. I said, hey, you know, that somebody here is opening up a bunch of accounts in my name, and, you know, we need to pursue this. And, you know, I just, at that time, I was very sick. I was on a lot of medications, and, you know, I was giving, at that point, a very low prognosis, chances of survival. So they just sort of wrote it off and, you know, said, yeah, okay, whatever. You know, even if it is somebody stealing your identity, how do you know it's somebody in the hospital? And, you know, you're never going to be able to catch them, and even if you do, how are you going to prove it? And it was just, you know, let it go.
Okay, so everybody's telling you to let it go, but you realize you shouldn't let it go.
Well, you know, I wanted to, and there were times where I did, and I said, okay, I got to focus on surviving the next day or the next week. I mean, it was really
literally surviving.
Surviving.
Okay.
Yes. No, I mean, I was on my deathbed. I don't know how many times, but it was, you know, I think the second attempt at a transplant, which was Christmas Eve that year, I had a bad reaction. I was immediately hospitalized and pretty much unconscious for most of a week, and I think I was in the inpatient for 2 weeks. And when I got out of the hospital, I got another delivery of a bunch of mail, and there was a stack of collection notices and new accounts opened. So, I mean, this was just spiraling very quickly.
And, you know, to kind of keep this in perspective, right, you are struggling and fighting for your life. You are battling pain that no one could possibly imagine.
Your body's on fire, yeah.
Literally.
Literally.
And at the same time, you're going to try and trust people at a hospital, which you would think you can trust, with an issue, and they're blowing you off.
Yeah. I mean, they patronized me. They said, you know, like I said, they, you know, this, even if you know, how do you know it's somebody at the hospital? And, you know, we don't have time for this, basically. You know, they sent down a HIPAA compliance officer to, you know, patient privacy rights and everything like that. But, you know, they didn't follow up in any way. So
what, did he just blow you off? Or was he
pretty much. They just patronized me. I said, look, I want an investigation into this. You know, I want you to look into this.
Okay.
And, you know, we got to figure this out. It's somebody here at this facility that's doing this to me.
Do you end up going through with the transplant?
I did. It was a transplant using my half-sister that I'd only met a few years before. And she happened to work at the Fred Hutch Cancer Research Center in Seattle, which is why I went there. We did this experimental procedure, but unfortunately, it didn't work. So
no. Eric manages to track down the thief's name, and he's suddenly afraid that identity theft could turn deadly. Find out why next. Stay with me. You decide to become your own investigator while you're fighting for your life.
The key to this was finding a video. Obviously, there's cameras everywhere.
Look under that winter coat. You'll see an important clue.
We are getting in the head of a criminal mastermind. How he was able to bring in between $25,000 and $150,000 a week stealing people's identities.
All of us are dedicated to breaking the law, ripping people off.
So once you get the information, what do you do with it? Welcome back to the Security Brief. We've been talking to Eric, a man who was fighting, literally, for his life against leukemia, only to discover that someone from the hospital had stolen his identity. But who? So here's one of the many facets of this story that just blows me away. No one's really paying attention.
No, I
tried to
report
it. So you decide to become your own investigator.
Absolutely. I had to be.
Okay. And again, you decide to become your own investigator while you're fighting for your life.
Right.
Okay. Just want to make sure we... Right. So what do you do?
Well, the first thing I did was call my friends in the banking business in California and said, can you please run a tri-merge on my credit report? In other words, get all three reports from all three agencies and fax it up to me. They did it. I saw an address that was being used. You can go online and do a title search to find out who owns the property. And I started pursuing the evidence.
So now you find the property of the person
where my credit cards are being sent, or the credit cards in my name. Yeah.
Okay, so we all, just to clarify, so the individual that is responsible for ordering credit cards in your name, you're able to track down where those credit cards are being sent?
Absolutely.
Okay, what's the next step?
Well, I contacted the listed owner of the property. It was an older woman who mentioned to me that the actual property owner was in prison for bank robbery and murder.
Okay, so hence Hence the thought of fear and apprehension now, but what am I getting myself into?
This could be a whole gang or a crime syndicate or who knows what I'm up against, but now all of a sudden I felt there was a very real physical threat.
What's going through your mind at that point?
They knew where we lived. They knew the address of the apartment. I mean, obviously, if they knew all my records, you know, that they knew what address I was living at, I felt that my mother's life and safety was in jeopardy. I mean, they could come and,
do whatever they wanted to.
Basically get rid of us and make it look like a robbery or something like that, and nobody would ever know the difference. So, at that point, they probably knew I was onto them.
So do you stop there?
No, I got to get to them before they get to me.
You're going out fighting for this, and you are outside the hospital, correct?
Yes, yeah, I'd leave the hospital and, you know, do whatever it takes to get this, so.
And then also there's threats now, if this is related to the hospital, was there something that could happen to you at the hospital?
Well,
because you don't
knows?
Know.
Yes, I mean, you know, if this person is working, I don't know who it is. Could be this person, that person, could be the nurse hooking up chemos to me. If they put a double dose in there, I'm gone.
Right.
So, I mean, I was literally so tense every minute, you know, watching my back and worried and questioning everybody and suspicious of everybody. And, I mean, I was visibly angry and upset.
Rightfully so.
And this stress was also threatening my life.
So, Cindy, let me ask you. You're seeing all of this going on right now. What are you thinking? What are you feeling? What's going through your head?
Well, Eric is adopted, and I firmly believe, at least in his case, adopted people, their identity is more extremely important to them than, say, to me, you, or I, because he luckily found out his background and his natural mother and his natural father and his natural siblings. But his identity is his very own. It was horrifying for me because he would not let it go, and I wanted him to.
All right, so by the same token then, Cindy, I got to ask you. So now Eric, who's really grappling now physically, emotionally, right, he comes to you and asks for your help to get out and do what?
Well, I had to hook up his IVs, put the medicine in a backpack. Luckily, my husband was up that weekend. Once Eric found the address on Martin Luther King Drive, we did a drive-by shooting.
But can we kind of just like reclassify in Cindy terms the drive-by shooting?
The drive-by shooting was Eric got out at the house and took pictures of the home and the barbecue grill that was next to the home.
Okay.
And
hence, that's your shooting.
That's my drive-by shooting.
There you go. All right. Beautiful.
Camera shooting.
I love her. What a great woman. Great woman. Okay. Camera shooting. So Eric gets out of the car.
Yes.
And go ahead.
And he's taking pictures, and I'm going, get back in the car. Eric, get back in the car. And he finally got back in the car, and off we went.
So now what happens next?
Yeah. Excuse me. Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I was sort of up against a wall, so I said, wait a minute. You know, all the mail that's going to this house, it's in my name. It's my mail. So we figured out what post office delivered to that house, and I went in there pretty angrily and said, how can you be delivering, you know, piles of credit cards to a house where only, a woman and two kids live? I found out who was renting the house. And, I demand that you stop, you know, delivering any mail with the name Eric Drew on it. And, you know, they said, well, here, fill this out. We'll forward everything to you. And so I started to get all the bills and list of charges, and all the criminals' mail came to me.
So you turned them back around, turned the table. So now the mail going to that house is now coming to you.
Absolutely.
Who else do you get involved?
Well, I tried to get everybody involved. I called, the police. I called the FBI, the Secret Service. The only people that even took a statement from me were the Federal Postal Inspection Service, but
police, nothing,
ignored me. They actually
FBI,
opened a case and sent me a letter the next day saying your case has been closed because of lack of evidence. When they never even talked to me.
Who do you go to next?
I was so aggravated about this. I said, you know, these people are ignoring me. This is a very serious crime, and nobody's taking it seriously. So I just started writing press releases.
So you actually get the media involved.
I got the media involved.
Okay, we have a bit of that news story. Let's take a look.
I've got people like this, you know, stealing my identity, ruining my credit. It's just unbelievable to me that people would, you know, or target people that are considered terminally ill.
Was there ever a break in the case?
Absolutely. So in my investigations, I obviously, you know, I knew where the charges were. I interviewed the storekeepers. I got descriptions of the guy. But the key to this was finding a video. Obviously, there's cameras everywhere. So it just takes people to actually, you know, get out of their seat and go look for the video. And that was difficult to do. A Lowe's home improvement store, I knew the time and date of the charges. I knew they had cameras in there. But they just didn't want to bother to go back and spend the time to do it. Finally, after getting it in the news, the news reporter, you know, followed up with them and said, called the Lowe's Home Improvement and said, hey, this guy's for real. This is serious. Can you please get me that video? And they agreed to turn it over to the police, which brought it to the news station. And we aired a video of the man.
And you know what? Let's check out the security footage that reveals Eric's identity thief right now. Let's take a look.
Winter coat. You'll see an important clue. The fake Eric Drew is wearing hospital scrubs.
Who is this mystery man? Is it someone Eric recognizes? Find out next. Stay with me. And this really sticks right in my damn throat. Yeah. This guy's dying, and they ask you to sign a document.
The hospital staff were just in absolute shock. I mean, they were in tears. Nobody could even look me in the eye.
Was there any reason why you think he singled you out? We are getting in the head of a criminal mastermind. Now, he was able to bring in between $25,000 and $150,000 a week stealing people's identity.
All of us are dedicated to breaking the law, ripping people off.
So once you get the information, what do you do with it? Back to the security brief. We've been speaking with Eric, a young man who was dying from leukemia when he discovered a stranger stole his identity. Determined to clear his name, Eric risks his own life to track down the perpetrator and bring him to justice. Did you have any idea who this person was?
No. I mean, once I didn't recognize the person in the video right away. It was a pretty grainy video.
Right.
So, but what we did, we aired it on the 5 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock news. And by the next day, 30 people had called in and said, this is Richard Gibson. He's a lab tech, a phlebotomist and lab tech at the Fred Hutch Cancer Research Center, one of the top, you know, cancer research centers in the country. And that's him. I mean, we all know it. They recognize the jacket.
Take us through what goes on next.
So I went in the next morning. I had to be in the hospital. Even though I was out investigating this, my body couldn't produce blood. So I had to be in there three or four times a day to get blood transfusions to keep me alive. And I went in the next morning, and the hospital staff were just in absolute shock. I mean, they were in tears. Nobody could even look me in the eye.
How about an I'm sorry?
Well, it was an unspoken sorry in a big way.
The spoken part should have come out.
Well, from the administration, eventually, yes. But the hospital staff that had sort of ignored me and patronized me and probably told me I was crazy, and they couldn't believe that it was one of their own, that they spend their whole lives and careers trying to help people and save people, and one of their own is doing this to the patients.
Well, the fact is, one of their own did do it to one of the patients, and they should have stepped up and apologized right away, profusely.
Yeah. The administration, they did. They did. But
police didn't do anything. Law enforcement didn't do anything. You had to go to the media to bring this all back. You, through your efforts and your efforts alone, this piece of crap gets locked up, right?
No.
Wait a second. I mean, doesn't...
So he doesn't show up to work that day. It was a Friday. He went on the run. The police went around looking for him. They put out an APB on him. 4 days later, on a Tuesday, he shows up at the police department with a lawyer to turn himself in. And within an hour, they just let him go.
Wait a second. They just let him go?
Let him go. He lawyered up. The lawyer went in there and said, what evidence do you have to charge my client? They said, well, we don't have any evidence because they never took any from me.
Because you had all the evidence.
Because I had all the evidence.
Because you did all the investigating. Go figure. Maybe if they would have asked you for it.
Right.
They would have had evidence.
Precisely.
Okay. I got to come back to something as well because I can't let the hospital off on this. Because this, when I heard about this, out of all the things that have happened, this really sticks right in my damn throat. Yeah. I got to tell you this. So while you're fighting for your life, they realize they screwed up. This is their guy. They own this. It's done on their watch.
Right.
And they ask you to sign a document.
Well, they basically wanted to limit their liability. You know, they basically asked me, what do we need to do to get you to sign a release of liability?
So what'd they offer you? Because I know they had to offer you something.
Yeah, it was a small nominal amount to cover attorney's fees and things like that. You know, I never filed a suit against the hospital. At the time, my thinking was, well, one, I'm being treated here. I don't want to sue a hospital I'm being treated at. You know, then if the doctors are mad at me, that could be, you know, cost me my life. So, and then you know,
that's
my
family.
Sort of
like getting the pilot angry.
Yeah, my
right?
family's conservative. Yeah. You know, we come from the old stock where, you know, you don't go around suing people. And the hospital, you know, in my eyes at the time, they didn't do anything proactive to really try to hurt me. They didn't make a conscious decision to do something that says we're going to do this even though we know it's going to hurt somebody.
All right. So, but I got to jump in here real quick because I got to let you know something from a law enforcement perspective, from a security perspective. Empirically, hospitals are plagued with security issues.
Absolutely.
Okay? Identity theft breeds in hospitals.
Very
okay?
easy.
No question about it. This is something they should have known. This is something they should have been ahead of, not behind of.
Correct.
They did not do the right thing. Period, end of story. Now, what happened to Gibson?
So, I was so furious when they released him that, you know, of course I'm doing interviews on the TV, so I'm screaming bloody murder saying they let him go and this is, you know, this really is a federal crime. I demand he be prosecuted under these new HIPAA laws. If this is not a direct violation of my patient privacy, then what is? I called the Justice Department in Washington, D.C. and I said I demand he be prosecuted in federal court.
So you prompted this?
Yes.
You prompted the federal investigation?
Absolutely.
You're the one that promulgated a HIPAA investigation.
Correct.
Take this monster-sized softball and lob it to them.
Absolutely.
Okay, so now what do they do?
Finally, I got a call back from one of the head FBI guys, fraud guys, and he says, you know, I'm very sorry that we've sort of ignored you up until now. You've done a great job investigating this, and we're finally going to take this case from you and get it off your hands. And we'll have an FBI investigator in the Seattle Bureau call you tomorrow.
And what happens from that? Let's fast forward. What do they do?
They first came and said, well, you know, this is a new law. We've never prosecuted anyone under this law. We don't even know how to do it. And I said, look, you've got him on all these federal accounts of fraud and mail fraud and all these other federal offenses. Why don't you just offer him a plea bargain that if he pleads guilty to HIPAA, you'll let him go to these other things, slap him on the wrist and get a precedent.
So what I was really fascinated with, and Gibson's obviously as low as they come, you know?
Yeah,
but he's also stupid as the day is long, which I enjoy this part of
it. He's a sociopath.
He ends up copping to this, but how's he do it? Tell me that story.
He has a nerve, I tell you. He goes and files for unemployment benefits because he was fired from the hospital. So he goes to his unemployment hearing and basically cops to what he did.
So he goes to the unemployment hearing, and he asks for unemployment benefits.
In court, in a circuit judge, you know.
In front of a circuit judge, because he got fired from the hospital he was working at when he stole your identity because he thought you were dying.
Right. He wanted some free money.
You, pal, are going to rot so deep in hell, I can't even tell you. All right, so to finish this up real quick, what's he cop to in front of the judge?
Basically admits to what he did And the judge just looked at him and said, this is, in 25 years on the bench, this is the most despicable thing I've ever seen.
You know.
And denied your benefits.
Gibson was found guilty, but will his punishment fit the crime? Also, find out how to keep yourself out of the crosshairs of an identity thief. Stay with me. Clearly, the hospital victimizes you.
Yes.
This guy victimizes you.
Yeah.
And the bank's victimizes you. How can we protect our personal information from being stolen from these guys? We'll meet a former identity thief and Secret Service informant who's here to tell us how he was able to bring in between $25,000 and $150,000 a week stealing people's identities. And Elizabeth writes, I hear the term phishing, but I don't understand what it is and how it works. Can you explain that?
I can.
Welcome back to the Security Brief. Today's show is about determination, identity theft, and the fight for justice. A man hell-bent on clearing his name after having his identity stolen by a hospital worker who was providing him care. The thief is caught. Will there be justice for Eric? How are you doing now?
I'm doing good. I have physical issues. You know, most of the treatments damaged my body a lot. I have mechanical joints and have mobility issues, but I can play golf and hike, and I'm really actually
fantastic.
Very healthy.
Thank God, man.
You know,
that's
and because of the amazing stem cell transplant that I eventually had, my blood is female from a baby girl, so I'm
That's beautiful, man. That is absolutely amazing. You know what? You're a walking miracle and an inspiration, honest to God.
Thank you. So
what was Gibson sentenced to?
So he was basically given a slap on the wrist because they did what I recommended. They dropped all the federal charges except for the HIPAA violation so that he would plead guilty to that. He was given a slap on the wrist, I think 16 months in federal prison, and had to pay maybe $15,000 in restitution, mostly to the banks.
Was there any reason why you think he singled you out?
Yeah, because we were the same sex and relatively the same age. That's all you really need to do to match, because when you're walking around with a, you know, he actually had a driver's license with his name and my picture on it. You can order them on the internet. You get them within a couple weeks.
But Eric, why you though? Why did he single you out?
Because I was being given 100% terminal diagnosis. There was no chance of survival. And he looked at my disease, he looked at the situation, and said, this guy's not going to be here in a few weeks. Nobody will be the wiser.
When we go to a hospital, we are supposed to feel ultimately safe. Yeah. And here you are fighting for your life, and this piece of crap reads your personal file, reads that you are terminal, you're not supposed to live, and figures you won't miss it.
Right.
Am I reading that right?
Yeah. I mean, he basically said, look, this will be a victimless crime, and you know, nobody will be the wiser, and I can I'll probably get away with $50,000 or so in charges, and then move on.
So let's talk about that victimless crime. So, clearly, the hospital victimizes you.
Yes.
This guy victimizes you.
Yes.
And the banks victimize you.
I hold the banks more responsible than anybody. I think of Gibson as a petty thief. You know, if you leave a pot of money sitting at the end of your driveway, that's on private property, but somebody that's dishonest is going to walk by and pick it up.
Okay.
Easy money, right?
All right.
So he's a petty thief and a crook. The banks operate the credit business in violation of multiple federal statutes. They know they do. They make conscious business decisions to, in essence, cause the identity theft epidemic. I mean, Gibson never even filled out an application. All he did was call him and say, I'm Eric Drew, give me a credit card. And
that's all he did.
Yeah. Unbelievable. And then, even after the prosecution, even after I went through all this effort and we prosecuted the guy in federal court, and their lawyers were there at the prosecution demanding restitution for the $2,000, whatever.
The banks. The banks' lawyers were there asking for $2,000.
Absolutely, they were there. But then they refused to take these off my credit report for 2 to 3 years, reporting me 90 days past due on these accounts, sending me into a financial spiral that lasted 10 years.
Wait a second, but you went to the bank, they know it's not you.
Absolutely.
They know it's
not you.
Why won't they take it off your credit report?
Because they just don't really care.
How long does it take you to get where you need to be? What do you do with the banks?
Well, when I realized that they were in violation of multiple federal statutes and were, you know, still, you know, pressing this on me, I worked very hard to find a really good attorney, and I filed a lawsuit against 6 major banking institutions and all the 3 credit reporting agencies.
How long did it take you?
After 8 years of intense litigation, I beat every single one of them.
Oh, man. How about that? How about that? Yeah. How about that?
So
that's beautiful.
Consumers now have new legal precedent that they can use when, if they're victims of identity theft and the banks have really messed up their lives, to go and get very serious damages and, punitive damages against the banks, et cetera. Other people are getting, you know, $18 million awards.
Yeah, but
now
you,
and
did
stuff,
so. You did it. You did it. You absolutely did it. And, you know, along those lines, here to share the legal perspective on identity theft is criminal defense attorney Bob Bianchi. Bob, welcome to the Security Brief. Thanks so much for coming
back.
Always a pleasure to have you here, Bob.
Thank you.
How can we protect our personal information from being stolen from these guys?
Yeah, so prior to me being a defense attorney, I was a prosecutor for many years, and we went out into the community and tried very, very hard to target harden, as we would call it, people who were victims, usually vulnerable populations, much like Eric, the young, the elderly in nursing homes, hospitals, as you mentioned, Paul, to target harden them so that they are not as vulnerable when they get into the situation. Here are a couple things. One, you should always be prepared, and your audience should know, to have somebody that can step in on your behalf when you become sick or ill, not only to take care of medical decisions, but also to kind of watch the store. That's what exactly Eric's story is all about. The man looked for a vulnerable, the defendant looked for a vulnerable person, went after him, exploited his credit. The other thing you got to watch out for is the internet. People opening unknown emails where malware is placed onto their computers, and eventually all of their data and information is passed on. You got to be very careful of that. Install antivirus programs. Don't open up emails that you don't know. If you have a question, email the person and say, did you send me this email?
Right.
Very important fact is bad guys, that's how they're doing it today. Everything in the criminal world, as you know, Paul, is really surrounding computers now more than anything else.
And Bob, one last question. What do people need to know if, in fact, their information gets in the hands of the wrong people?
Yeah, I mean, listen, Eric did a great job, but there are a lot of other things you can do. I mean, the first thing is you have to be, like Eric, you have to be very vigilant, okay, because people aren't going to just take care of it for you. The first and most important thing is you got to be vocal. You got to shake the tree. You got to write letters. You got to document. You got to write to the Social Security Administration, which a lot of people don't recognize, and let them know that your identity has been compromised. You have to write to the three credit agencies and file the appropriate reports with them. All of this should be done certified mail so that you have proof of it.
Right.
And you have to make sure you contact even your Division of Motor Vehicles, because as Eric said, what a very common technique is, it's easy to get a license. Once they have the license, once they have your Social Security and date of birth, it becomes very easy for them to open up credit lines in your name.
Excellent information, Bob. And for everyone listening, this information that Bob has given us now, we're going to have up on the Security Brief website. But Eric also has a website. Tell us about that.
So I've been a patient advocate for 13 years. A nonprofit was started in my name. We're launching WeHeal.org. It's WeHeal.org. And think of a Facebook for patients, where you're going to have hundreds of medically specific communities. So when you're diagnosed with a serious or terminal illness, you can go there, network with other patients and
That's
advocates,
fantastic.
And learn about what you need to do before you even go in and see the doctor.
That's fantastic, right? Isn't that great? For more information about Eric's website, you can go to our website, securitybrieftv.com. Bob, thank you very, very much for being here. It's always a pleasure to have you. And Eric, you are a star, my friend. Thank you very much for being here. Coming up, Criminal Masterminds. We'll meet a former identity thief and Secret Service informant who's here to tell us how he was able to bring in between $25,000 and $150,000 a week stealing people's identities. Stay with me. We'll be right back. If you're in the New York City area, I want to extend a personal invitation to you to come to our studio and watch the Security Brief live. To get free tickets, go to securitybrieftv.com. I can't wait to see you here. Welcome back to the Security Brief. Today, we are getting in the head of a criminal mastermind. Former identity thief and Secret Service informant Brett Johnson is here to discuss how he was able to bring in between $25,000 and $150,000 a week stealing people's identities. Brett, welcome to the Security Brief.
Great to be here.
Great. And, you know, in the true spirit of the Security Brief, as I was saying before, it's great that you're here because we are a solution-based show.
Right.
And so having you here really will provide invaluable information that many people would just normally ever have.
Well, I'm looking forward to doing what I can.
Yeah, well, we're very grateful to have you here. So why don't you tell everybody how this all started for you?
Well, I started a website called counterfeitlibrary.com with a couple other fraudsters. One out of Canada knew how to make fake IDs. Another guy out of Los Angeles knew how to make fake Social Security cards. We really didn't know much at the time, so we engaged in a lot of eBay fraud, PayPal fraud, that type of thing. We would even go as far as anybody that wanted to learn, we'd teach them how to do that type of stuff. Pretty soon after that, we switched domains over to shadowcrew.com.
Shadowcrew.com.
Right.
So it really sounds like, in essence, you're just creating a business model of crime.
That's exactly what we did.
So once you get the information, what do you do with it?
What we do with it, usually the credit card information is usually online. We buy items, cash them out. Or we make IDs with a real person's information, our faces on it, commit crimes under that person's name, steal bank information, get passports to travel on, launder money under that person's name, open bank accounts under that person's name to launder the money. A lot of the information has ended up being sold online on the black market or even given away for people to use however they wish.
Now, you're making significant cash here.
Yes.
You end up getting arrested, right? And how does the Secret Service get involved?
The big Shadow Crew bust happened October of 2004.
Okay.
I was the only guy that really got away. I was the only higher up that was not arrested that day. The FBI picks me up February of 2005, passing counterfeit cashier's checks. Secret Service swoops in, takes over the investigation. They offer me a job. Working for them, helping identify cyber criminals.
Which, of course, you jump at, because that beats the hell out of going to prison.
I would do whatever I could to stay out of prison.
Okay.
All right? While I was working for them, I taught the dynamics of how these criminals operate.
Sort of following in the steps of like a Frank Abagnale.
Exactly. That was what I was trying to do.
Okay, there you go. All right. I know Frank. That's another subject. All right. Now we have time. We have time for one question. It's from Elizabeth on Facebook.
Okay.
And Elizabeth writes, I hear the term phishing, but I don't understand what it is and how it works. Can you explain that?
I can. What you need to realize is phishing relies heavily on social engineering. And what I mean by that is my ability to trick the target or the potential victim into doing what I want them to do. In this case, opening an email, clicking a link. Technology helps in that it gives the victim a false sense of security for me. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, the format of this is actually pretty simple. What you do is you acquire a mailing list. Then I create a business email website that will mimic either the business or the government entity I'm pretending to be.
Right.
Send that email out. Usually, it'll prompt someone to update their account information.
But you're sending it to millions of people.
Millions.
So even if you get a 1% or 2% hit, you're making a lot
right.
of cash.
If I'm halfway competent on my job,
right.
a certain percent of people will end up clicking through on this email.
Okay.
All right. Now, depending on the nature of this phish, I can either collect the information they enter into a form, or I can install some sort of malware on their system to use at a future date. All right?
Mm-hmm.
The information that's gathered, I'll go through, see how me and my group can immediately profit by it. All the other information is either sold or even given away on these boards as a gesture of goodwill.
So, you know, I'm going to go back to something Bob mentioned earlier, and the safest thing is, you know what, if you get an email from somebody and you aren't 100% sure, calling to make sure it was them.
Exactly.
And the information you've given us today has been great. Brett, thank you so much.
I appreciate it.
I really appreciate you being here. We'll be right back. Stay with me.
Hi, Paul. Today on Survival 101, I'm going to tell you the three ways to surveil someone who you think may be harming you. So perhaps you think somebody's poisoning your food, maybe an ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend, a spouse or former spouse, or maybe you think someone's stealing money from your purse or stealing something out of your house. So we are very fortunate to live in a day and age where we have so many technological advances, where it is very easy and inexpensive to surveil someone. So you're probably wondering what I'm holding right here and what I've got this stuffed animal. Well, the first way to surveil someone is via nanny cams. So cameras are so small these days, can be placed in a variety of items. For instance, you can buy stuffed animals that have built-in cameras. So you can put this around your house, have the camera going, and nobody will be the wiser. You can do it in clocks, you can do it in picture frames. Again, if you just go on the internet and do a search for hidden cameras or spy cameras, it is mind-boggling the amount of items that have built-in cameras that you can just put around your house that nobody will be the wiser. Also, what I'm holding here, and this may be a little harder to see, is this looks like a typical clicker for your vehicle. So it even has the buttons for opening your car, locking your car, and also opening the trunk. But this is not actually a vehicle clicker. This is a spy camera. So this right here, where the beam comes out to usually unlock your car, is really a camera and it has night vision. So I can set this on the corner of a table, I can set this in my house, wherever I want, and even at night, this is recording, so I can see what's going on, I can see if somebody's taking things off my desk or maybe stealing money out of my wallet. So find a nanny cam, something that works for you, that blends in with your house. That is the first and probably the easiest way to surveil someone who you think may be trying to harm you. The second way is via GPS tracking technology. So if you want to know somebody's whereabouts, again, just like the nanny cam, super easy these days to know where someone is going. So if you have access to their cell phone, you can put tracking apps on their cell phone, so they'll have no idea that you know if they're at work or if they're hanging out with their friends or wherever they are. If you don't have access to their cell phone, but you can get to their car, you can buy GPS tracking devices to put underneath a vehicle. So these are small, you know, they're about 2x2 pack of cigarettes type size, and they're magnetic. So you can buy one of these GPS trackers, just put it underneath someone's car, anywhere there's metal, and again, you'll know everywhere they go, you'll know where they stop at stoplights, the speed limit they're traveling, so if they're speeding. So it's very easy to see if you're worried about someone following you or coming to your own work, you can just get online and it tells you via this tracking device where they are at every minute of the day. The third and final way to surveil someone is via physical surveillance. Now, this is more expensive if you're gonna hire somebody to do it, but if you really wanna know somebody's whereabouts, you don't wanna take any chances whatsoever, You can hire private investigators, private surveillance teams, and you may need just one person who's gonna follow this person around, take pictures kind of like they do in the movies so you know exactly what's going on. You know, perhaps you think your spouse is doing something illegal, something drug related. You may wanna get physical evidence, so you may want those pictures and may not have videos at home that are gonna work, but you may need boots on the ground. So you can do this yourself. I wouldn't recommend it because it is a art form and a skill. I would hire somebody and make sure that they're getting you videos, photos, whatever information you need as they're running this physical surveillance for you. So hopefully none of us ever have to do this, but because life is so unpredictable, you never know when you're gonna need to protect yourself or the life of a loved one via surveillance. One final bonus tip I'm gonna give you today about surveillance is to back up everything, make multiple copies, give it to friends or people you trust. So if you're putting hidden cameras and you have videos, immediately download that on your computer. Make sure you just send it to someone you trust. If you have physical surveillance going on, as soon as you get those photos or get videos, the same exact thing. Because if the person you're trying to surveil get their hands on those, they're of course gonna wanna destroy them, delete them, so all your evidence is gone. So back up everything every single day. Don't take any chances for leaving a camera going for a week because you may lose that critical information you need.
All right, now I think I've seen a new low in this world today. A hospital worker steals a dying man's identity basically because he's too sick to fight back, goes on a shopping spree, then files for unemployment when he's caught. The hospital conveniently has the victim sign a legal document ensuring he won't sue them. Really? But then you have the story of a young man with a spectacular spirit that through his efforts and his efforts alone, the identity thief is brought to justice. This must be a lesson for all of us about the seriousness of identity theft and the precautions we must take to ensure this does not happen to us. Please, go to our website at securitybrieftv.com for information on how to prevent this as well as how to contain it if it happens to you. So on behalf of our executive producers, Terry Murphy and Patrick Murphy, and the greatest TV team in America, be safe, be well, God bless. Thank you.